complicated. And after Alexandra Porubechko, okay, it's okay. So the first concern, in particular, the Italian case, the second, the Romanian case, and for your happy, you remember that I'm not the discussant, so Professor Negroni, okay, it's arriving. Ah, sorry. And so, start. Okay.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. I'm going to present a paper written along with Professor Barantuana, who's not here, as you can see. So let's start. As you can see in the graph, after a long expansive cycle, for the last 10 years, international migration in Europe, in Southern Europe, and of course in Italy, has been declining. The net migration rate had become positive in the 60s in Europe, then in the first half of the 70s in Southern Europe and in Italy, and had been rising until the first decade of 2000, but then has started to decline. Over the last 40 years, Europe has experienced many migratory flows. Consider only the last two before the immigration crisis due to the refugees emergency, exit from former communist countries and the entry into Mediterranean countries. This second flow has been striking for its speed and magnitude. Italy has contributed significantly to the writing of this new chapter of international migration. Today in Italy, as you know, live about 6 million of foreigners people, while 40 years ago there were around 200,000. We, in this paper, describe 40 years of Italian migration, always distinguishing between the center-north and the south islands of Italy, as the migratory histories of these two parts of the countries are quite different. We show how the stop-and-go migration trends of recent years can be understood in light of population demography and the demand and supply of labor market structural changes, and the inability, or the lack of will, of public authorities to govern entries from and exits abroad. We observe also how several persistent and structural traits of the Italian society have shaped foreigner presence in Italy in ways much different than those seen in Central and Northern Europe. The relationship between Italy and migrations during the last 40 years was shaped by five factors. The changes in the economy and in the labor market, the demographic shifts, internal territorial imbalances, the strong family structure of the Italian society, and last, the regulatory shortcomings. Let's go first with the changes in the economy and in the labor market. To highlight the relationship between migrations and their potential demographic and economic pull factors over the 40 years between 1977 and 2018, we use three simple indicators. It looks complicated, but it's not. Demographic factors are summarized with working population turnover ratio. That is the ratio between young and old working population, is the green line. The economic factors are observed using the unemployment rate. One of you know that, is the broken blue line. Both indicators should have an inverse relationship with the net number of migrants. This is our main hypothesis. Finally, to allow for spatial and time comparisons, migrations are measured using the net migration rate, calculated as the ratio between the net number of migrants and the average population in the period to which the balance itself refers to. In Italy, the immigration boom of the first decade of the 21st century, that you can see on the graph, was primarily caused by a situation of full employment across large areas of the center north, accentuated by a dramatic lack of unskilled labor due to the exhaustion of a reserve army of labor from South Islands, and the rapid increase in the figures of young high school and university graduates. Symmetrically, the immigration bust that followed 2008 and the resumption of emigration abroad were determined by the destruction of income and work generated by the economic crisis, which hit foreigners people particularly hard compared to native Italians. The first sign of economic recovery suggests that if improvements continue, maybe not, Italy could once again become attractive, even if changes in the productive system make it difficult to imagine another immigration boom similar to that at the beginning of the century. Second point, the demographic shift. The change in composition of the Italian population forms the backdrop to the inversion of the net number of migrants due to international migration. Beginning in 1995 in the central north, and in 2011 in South Island, the number of young people aged 15 to 24 became smaller than those aged 55 to 64, as you can see in the graph. The imbalance in working population turnover is dramatic when considering not just the quantity, but also the quality of those who get in and get out at working ages. The decade of the immigration boom is also the period that saw each year a potential shortage of 400,000 non-graduates, as shown by this graph, is the green line under the horizontal axis in the graph. This shortage was much smaller in previous years, while it remained larger, even tending to decrease after 2011. Note that the shortage mentioned is of the same order of magnitude as the net number of migrants into international migration during the same period. Indeed, between 300,000 and 500,000 per year, as shown by the broken red line above the horizontal axis in the graph. Third point, the internal territorial imbalances. Economics and demographics affected the Central North and South Islands very differently. As you can see in the figure, this one, in the Central North, migratory attraction was very strong. There were two main areas of attraction, many of you know that. In the historically Milan, Turin, Genoa, so-called industrial triangle, and in Rome, foreign immigrants took on jobs previously occupied by Italian workers coming from other regions, filling their reservoir of unskilled jobs. In the northeast and central regions, excluding Rome, the immigration flows from abroad was instead, after centuries, the first substantial contribution of non-native population, again in order to fulfill the demand of the so-called 3D, third meaning, and dangerous jobs that Italians could now afford to refuse. In the South Islands, on the other hand, and on the right side of the slide, a lasting weak economy pushed immigration towards the center north. You can see that looking at the red line, which is under level zero in the x-axis until 2006, and then again after 2012, meaning that there was more emigration than immigration, even if this is to a lesser extent than in the first 30 years following the war. At the same time, however, processes of development and demographic changes translated into a considerable inflow of immigrants from abroad, accentuated by the comparatively greater presence of the books employment, particularly in the extensive agriculture and low tertiary touristic sector. Although the natural demographies of the center north and the south islands are now almost identical, the data do not show signs of closure of the gap between the two areas in terms of migratory behavior. So you can see that while in the center north, the total migration rate, the blue, the red line, is higher than the abroad migration rate, the blue line, in the south and island, the opposite is true. Much will depend on the economic trends. If the South Islands will continue to move to a slower or equal pace than the center north, it is hard to imagine a convergence in the migratory histories of these two parts of the countries. Fourth point, the strong family structure of Italian society. It is not possible to understand many of the characteristics of the immigration towards Italy without taking into account one more often neglected factor, the comparatively strong family structure of Italian society, reflected among the other things by a very close living proximities among relatives, the diffusion of family businesses, and the widespread home ownership. These traits, which Italy shares with Spain, Greece, and Portugal, three other countries that experienced an immigration boom around the beginning of the 21st century, have profoundly shaped migration and have determined particular patterns. I will mention only three of them. The huge growth and widespread presence of foreigners in the domestic service, already mentioned this morning, as you can see in this slide, and also the revival of this sector, because the sum of the two components of this line is higher across the time. The dispersion of immigrants throughout the country and a lack of ethnic ghettos, as you can find in some other European countries. I do not have data about that, but this is clearly stated in the scientific literature. So in a certain sense, Italy experienced a kind of unplanned and implicit integration. This was not determined by far-sighted political or administrative choices, but was driven from below by a deeply rooted societal structure. These features are well rooted, so unlikely to change in the near future or in the future. Rather, we can observe that some foreigners are seemingly infected by this Italian model, given that when economic conditions allow, the immigrants, tend to join Italians in the race to become homeowners, in choosing a home near relatives and in establishing family businesses. Last point, the regulatory shortcomings. We saw that as far as international migration began in the 70s, Italy never has a clear plan or strategy except for a brief period in the second half of the 90s. So neither active immigration nor integration policies were, over the course of this entire 40-year period, of great significance. Rather, the majority of foreign immigrants settled in Italy through four steps. De facto legal entry, with a tourist visa, for example, then fall in an undocumented status due to a stay longer than authorized by the visa or permits, then amnesty for those who could show they were in Italy before the amnesty itself, for the amnesties during the 90s, or who had a job in the 2000s, then a not managed integration process. As a matter of fact, migration and integration in Italy is mainly driven by mechanism of matching between labor supply and demand. If you watch at this slide, you can see that over the short run, at least, Italian amnesties worked rather well. The number of undocumented immigrants fell immediately after every amnesty, but then rises again due to the same mechanism already mentioned, until a new amnesty, generally after 4 years, is done. But right after scholars proudly claim that we have a new sociological law, this mechanism got stuck. Due to the fact that no amnesty has been done in the last 7 years, the number of undocumented immigrants rose now to about 500,000, according to the more reliable estimates you can see in the slide. A great part of the interruption of this long string of amnesties is due to the growing influence of a leading actor, the public opinion. I do not have time to go deeper in the analysis of this factor. I only highlight the fact that over the years, public opinion is the more and more disconnecting himself from the phenomenon, something similar to the fact Anico Bernard already told us. But this is true in many other countries of Europe. As you can see from this graph, showing one, of course, unsatisfactory indicator of attitudes towards immigrants. There is people saying there are too many immigrants in my country, compared with the net migration to the net migration numbers. To my knowledge, this is the only question we have, which has been repeated over the years with precisely the same words. So the only one with which we can do a time comparison. Migration was rising in the 80s and in the 90s, when the share of Italians agreeing with this sentence was declining. The opposite is true today. So the attitudes towards immigrants appear to have much more to do with the feeling of insecurity than with the magnitude of the phenomenon, as the comparison between this attitude and the unemployment rate suggests. This is the same graph, but compared with the unemployment rate in Italy, not with the net migration rate. This swinging management of the migratory process wasn't without consequences when Italy, left essentially on its own by other European countries after 2013, found itself having to face tens of thousands of requests for asylum by the migrants landing on its shores after having crossed the stretch of sea separating Libya from Sicily. The great complexity of providing rapid responses to asylum requests has resulted in paradoxical situation with youths who are parked for months or even years in often unsuitable places, almost always without work and with very uncertain prospects. But this difficulty also again proves that Italy is an immigration country where economic and demographic processes are almost left to play a major role with the politics, but not the bureaucracy, but the policy in the background. So, thank you.
And so I call Alexandra.
Yes.
About the Romanian case in people going to Germany. So.
Some of the countries in Eastern Europe to have a high, considerable amount of immigrants who are usually were encouraged to leave their country based on reason of ethnicity. I will, since everyone here is quite familiar with the phenomenon of integration of international migration, but I'm not sure how many of you are aware of the dimensions of the migration flow in Eastern Europe previous to the fall of the communist regimes. I will like, first of all, to explain the fact that regarding Romania, for instance, as you know, during the communist regime, so until 1989, the freedom of movement was severely framed. People didn't have the freedom to decide where to live, when to leave their country, except in very few cases. However, there were some parts of the population that benefited from a different kind of treatment, usually based on grounds of ethnic origins. And these were the cases of the people with German origins who lived in Romania, also people that originated from Jew communities all over the world who could easily return to Israel during the communist regimes, and also ethnic Hungarians who were encouraged or supported in their decisions to go back home. However, the possibility to return to the home country, which I will later on state, was sometimes a country that the person never even really knew, never lived there, but linked the person via some sort of family-inherited nationality, ethnicity, supported this act of return or immigration from Romania, usually conditioned by the Romanian government, by the paying of certain amounts of money per capita. So for each ethnic German who would return to Germany, the Romanian state received a certain amount of money depending on the capital the state considered was invested in that person. So if we are talking about a person with a higher level of education, a doctor, a professor, say, the young period of his life, so could still work, they would require a higher amount of money. This was not necessarily related to the content of the paper, but I wanted to create a landscape of what was happening regarding migration in Romania before 1999. So this was these three categories of ethnics were the only kind of people who were encouraged to move, to leave Romania in under legal conditions. As I believe you might have heard at some point, there were also Romanians who left the country but in irregular terms, often risking their own lives by crossing the borders in different various more or less risky ways. So returning to the aim of this paper and the information that is concerned. The main purpose was to link the migration network theory, which is used to explain the construction and the direction of the migratory flows, to the specificities of the migration process from Romania. And subsequently, I wish and I believe I have highlighted the effects or the influence of ethnicity in creating and driving these migratory networks, and thus constructing a balance or an evolution from ethnicity to the influence, the incentives offered by the migration networks to the process of emigration from Romania to Germany. The preliminary statements that were the basis, the foundation of my work regard the fact that until 1989, as I stated before, I tried to explain, ethnicity had a great or even a majority deal of influence on the immigration from Romania, that this type of migration, the ethnic migration, is linked both to the status of ethnic emigrants who were put in a more favored, we can say so, position by the fact that they were officially recognized by the state, as I told you. They did not have to risk their lives or the lives of their family members by endeavoring in dangerous migration attempts. So they were officially recognized by the state, they could live in, under perfect legal terms. They were also recognized when they arrived in their destination state, so they could get employment, benefit from social security and so on. And as a result, the ethnicity of these people, their, as I said earlier, alleged connection to a mother country, was practically turned into an instrument that helped fuel these flows and directed them towards certain destinations. The social network theory and its role in explaining international migrations is somehow linked to the social theories regarding groups in general. The focus is the elements that are most interesting in relation to the phenomenon of Romanian emigration to Germany and to other ethnic destinations, as I stated, are the ones that regard the fact that the existence of migration networks and migrants belonging to such a network, such a circle, give them a certain type of security when considering the decision to migrate, as well as offers them some sort of warranties regarding the possibilities, the opportunities they may or may not have in the places of destination. Also, it is usually common that these migration networks are based on ties such as family links or friendship. People get to know each other through mutual connections and sometimes even get linked to the common places of origin. So the example that is represented by a person who migrated before and was perhaps successful in his endeavor will determine those in his home community to make the same decision based on the preliminary experience that person is believed to have acquired and on the eventuality of the help, the assistance they can get from that person. So having such connections, such links, is an incentive in the decision to emigrate. Among the fundamental assumptions used by the network theory, I can sum up the ones that are most important to this topic. Usually, if someone has already migrated, he or she is more likely to migrate for a second time, so the previous experience is usually a factor that contributes to the later decision to emigrate, also extending on the family members and other members of the social group. The probably for migrating transnationally, that means usually not only to certain destinations, but changing destinations eventually, is more common for people who belong to the second wave of migrants or the second generation. Also, the most important type of networks that facilitate migration are family-based. And the more important it is to overcome the barriers or the obstacles in migrating internationally, the more important the role the social network plays in the decision and in the process of migration itself. Usually, the existence and the belonging to such a migration network reduces the cost of the migration act. In terms of financial expenses, of course, always regarded by an individual or a group of individuals when making such a decision, but also in terms of social costs, cultural costs, and even emotional or psychological costs. Because belonging to a group that you are previously familiar with makes it easier for the migrant to adapt to the destination country. As I said, it's much easier to find a job, you have recommendations, you have information on the labor market, on the qualifications required in some cases, you have a housing available in case of need. Also, it's easier to be in contact with maybe the ones left at home, the family members, and so on. So, aside from this contribution that is brought by the migration networks in the migration phenomenon itself, regarded at an individual level, it also means reducing the risks that are associated to such an act, to the migration act, which are somehow diminished by the previously stated reducement of the migration costs. And to sum up this part of the presentation, the existence of migratory networks usually contributes to directing the migration flows towards certain destinations. So, if a person belongs to a social group that already has connections to a place of destination, as we've seen regarding the migration of Romanians to Germany, they are more likely to migrate towards the same destination where their peers have already arrived. Now, regarding the Romanian migration to Germany, aside from the fact that, as I stated earlier, between 1989, it was one of the very few regular migrations that were possible from Romania. However, the fall of the communist regime meant opening the borders of Romania for all the people who wanted to emigrate. It is often claimed, and very much true, the immigration from Romania during the last 30 years is one of the most significant ones in Europe. The estimates varied among 2 million. They sometimes go up to unrecorded figures such as 4 or 5 million Romanians currently living abroad. This applies to a population of about 20 million inhabitants, so it's quite a significant number. But in the case of the Germans, there were some situations that were not supported by the state. Not everyone could receive that payment per capita in order to gain the freedom to go back to Germany. So the fall of the Ceausescu regime also meant easing an easier way for them to go back to Germany. Romania is the Transylvania, it's like the central part of Romania, was inhabited by people of German origins, grouped in under different names, that were even majoritary in certain part of Romania. Here on this map, you can see a part of the Romanian map. It's that area that I was telling you about, Transylvania. And you can see the most representative German groups, which are the Saxons. They founded some cities back in the 12th and 13th century. They founded seven cities in Romania, which still hold both the German name and the Romanian name. For instance, Hermannstadt, which is kind of in the middle of the map, is Sibiu, where you know the latest Council of Europe had its meeting. I think you may have heard. Okay, then there is the Banat area. You can see on the right side of the map, where there are the Swabians. And then there are some smaller communities up in the north. Swabians. Yes.
In Italian language is Swabia.
Okay. So these people have been living here for like 700 or 800 years, generation from generation, passing on the language, the traditions that they brought along when they first arrived here in Romania. After this great amount of time, several centuries, after the fall of the communist regime, about 90% of this population, which remember was majority in some of these regions, has decided to pack their belongings and move back to Germany in what the German press called as one of the most amazing ethnic migrations in modern Europe. Here is a map from 1925 with the biggest German communities in Central and Eastern Europe, and the circled one are the areas in Romania You can see they are pretty much the same ones as the ones that appeared on the previous map. I chose this picture to compare it to other countries that are in the same region. So the communities in Romania are significant even compared to other countries where German community lived, of course, except from the countries that were part of German territories for a longer period of time. So 90% of these ethnic Germans chose to leave their country, and practically some of the villages were even depopulated because these people took the opportunity of going back to Germany. Mind the fact that Romania was, and probably still is, a country economically very much far away from Germany. So despite the fact that their migration is and was considered as an ethnic one, it was also based on economic calculations and the interest or the idea of benefiting from the opportunity to live in a more developed society, which furthermore encouraged this type of ethnic migration. At that point, Germany, despite the fact that it had pretty much difficult to access citizenship system, it offered privileged conditions for the ethnic migrants as considered Ausländer or Germans who lived outside the borders and were not foreign citizens but their peers, their nationals coming back from home from abroad, and they needed assistance, protection and so on. What is interesting about these people is that when arriving in Germany and settling there, their communities were usually founded among themselves with very few German intruders, and they also chose areas that were somehow similar to the areas of origins. And furthermore, they developed type of migration that is quite particular for the area of Transylvania, which I showed you before, which is the circulatory migration. After settling in Germany, starting a life there, building houses, getting a job, I know, creating, opening their own economic activities, they often return to Romania either for vacation during the summer. In some areas they are also called now Sommersaxons, as Saxons who only return for the summer to vacation in Romania. Some of them, when retiring from their activity, choose to come back to Romania and rebuild their old family houses or build new ones, as many of them invest in this area, bringing back the know-how, the economic power they have gained abroad, and contributing to a significant development of this area, which currently is one of the most economically developed ones in Romania. There is a clear difference between that area and the more southern ones, which is pretty much the same in Italy as far as I know, but not due to the same reasons. Also, it is important to, I extracted some data from the Romanian National Institute of Statistics, which showed the number of emigrants from Romania from 1980 to 1989, and the second frame of time was 1990 to 2003. The periods of time were chosen in order to make a comparison of what happened before the fall of communism and immediately after the fall of communism. As you can see in both these periods of time, the number of Romanians who emigrated to Germany was the most significant among the other numbers. Until 1989, the emigrants whose destination was Germany were majoritary, 52%. After 1999, when the destination, as I said, were more diversified, the number decreased a little bit until 32.4%, but however, it still is the most significant among the others. The time frame frame stops at 2003 because this was pretty much the moment when this predilection of ethnic emigration towards Germany has stopped. Those who are ethnics and wanted to live had already left, and the ones that left for Germany afterwards were most of them non-ethnic migrants, but rather migrants who were driven towards this destination due to other kind of reasons. Usually in the study of emigration from Romania, the most commonly used periods of time are until 1989, from 1989 summer to the thousands, to 2000, I'm sorry, then we have, or even 2007, and then we have the period after Romania's accession to the European Union, 2007, when we gained acquired the freedom of movement within the common European space. So what happened after 2003 is that Germany ceased to occupy the main position as an emigration destination for Romanians. They started to choose countries that were more welcoming, to say so, in terms of legal conditions, also in terms of the language spoken, which was quite important, of in terms of the labor market and the kind of positions that were available for migrants. Another specificity, which is not necessarily object of this paper, of the Romanian immigration to Germany, but I think it is important to add here also in context to some of the other papers presented, is that Germany was, aside from an ethnically driven destination for Romanians, also first of all a destination for the, mainly for the highly qualified migrants. Those who were better educated chose more developed countries, but with less permissive conditions of access, such as Germany, while destinations such as Italy or Spain, for instance, were predominantly attractive for the less educated migrants, unfortunately, including due to the legal system, more allowing legal systems of these countries in terms of migrants, which is a thing that has pretty much changed during the past years. Some of these countries, including Italy, have become more and more reluctant to the idea of welcoming migrants. And countries such as Germany, for instance, have somehow relaxed their conditions due to the shortage on the labor market. So I think it should be interesting to make a comparison or observe this kind of evolution, but as I said, it is not the aim of this paper. However, after this period of time, after the 2000s, slowly the role of ethnicity as an incentive or as a directional instrument for the migration flows has been occupied by the network, the social networks, which were already created between migrants and non-migrants, former migrants and migrants, those who returned to Transylvania, and thus people were attracted to the same geographical and occupational areas in the destination. I will go to the conclusions, so I have time for the conclusions, okay? It is mainly a sum up of the statements above. First of all, regarding the typology of migration of Romanians, it has been observed, and it is also their declaration, that they travel in informal transnational networks, which are usually to exploit different branches of activities that become available in a certain area at a certain moment in time. This type of structured ethnic migration, first supporting the instrumentalized by the state authorities, later on turned into an informal ethnic migration, has become a circulatory type of migration, as these people come back to Romania, go back to Germany, bring a friend with them, usually their friend maybe invest in Romania, They take some workers from Romania to use in their activities back in Germany and so on, thus building like international bridges between their place of origin and place of destination when these two places by itself became somehow status names. They no longer have a destination and an origin, they are both their homes. Also, migration, in the case of German migration or migration to Germany is also most often recalled as a case from Eastern Germany is regarded as a case of a country with a clearly directed ethnic migration policy which privileged the migration of population coming from countries occupied by ethnic Germans and thus benefiting from the education and the skills that these people have acquired in the countries where they previously lived. The main factor regarding to the choice of migration to Germany is related to ethnic migration, almost since the communities of ethnic Germans living in that part of Romania were so significant, almost everyone in that area had a friend, a relative, people they knew who had German ethnicity, so they could benefit from this connection. This was mainly the principle, the main incentive for directing the migration flows. Except in very few cases, as I said, the link between these migrants and Germany was not so obvious, was not, it's not a good word, but I will use it since I don't have, they have an alleged German origin. They were never really, people who lived in that country, who knew the realities, they knew people, stories that their parents had told them from their grandparents, and so on. So they dreamed, they had stories, traditions regarding this connection. While documenting for some of this information in the paper, I read an interview with a German from a small community where a significant group of Romanians with ethnic with a German ethnicity had moved, and she said that when they returned, their traditions, their German traditions, were even better preserved than those of the people who actually lived in Germany, because they were very isolated there. They had no external influence in terms of culture, rituals, and so on, and they were even, in some terms, more German than the ones that actually live in Germany. And the fact that the migrant networks that were developed between Romania and Germany were mainly built on this type of ethnic groups, which directed them towards certain destinations and also certain areas of activity. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I call Professor Giorgio Negroni to discuss it. At the same time, I noted that here there are four illegal presents that have no sign here, so I pass this. Okay, abusive people are also here. One of them. She's one of them. Here, four Milano people. No, poi sì. Senza dentro. Dario ci fai.
Sono io.
Una e no. Four people. Ok.
Signature so.
Day. Yes. I'm not, it's not my idea. It's a European institution idea. Okay. Europe wants it. Okay. Okay. So, sorry, Giorgio. Sorry.
Unfortunately, I'm not an expert in other.